right? Yeah.
Thank you.
The only thing I can think of with some distance away is effectively taking the coffee break now. And, I'll just go and see how fun it is. Yeah, nobody's too bad. Yeah.
Good morning, everyone. Good morning. Welcome to the second session of our symposium. One of the difficulties in life you have to cope with if you live in Chicago is the fact that sometimes it's so difficult to move around the city. And unfortunately, there is a major problem on one of the expressways this morning. And our presenter, Nestor Medina, is caught up in the traffic, and they expect it to be about another 20 minutes before they're here. So that means we need to think about some rearrangement of our schedule. So clearly we're going to have a late start for this session, but our lunch is scheduled to run from 12:30 until 1:45. So what we'll do is maybe just make the coffee break between the two sessions this morning a little shorter, and then make our lunchtime break a little shorter. But you get the bonus of being able to continue to engage in those good conversations right now for a little while longer. So I apologize, but please bear with us, and as soon as Nestor Medina gets here, then we'll begin our session. Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, we will be able to start in just a minute or two.
Adjust this for my height so that I don't. Would that work?
Okay, good morning, everybody. Well, we're delighted to say that Nestor Medina, Dr. Medina, and our other guests who are caught in traffic have arrived, and so we're able to begin. Obviously, we're starting 30 minutes later than we'd anticipated, and so that means there need to be some changes in the schedule. Our first session now, we're starting at about 9:30, so the session will run until 11. Then we'll have a shorter coffee break until 11:20, so just 20 minutes between the two sessions. Then we'll begin again at 11:20 and run until 12:50. Okay. So this session 9:30 to 11, coffee 11 to 11:20. The next session 11:20 to 12:50, and then lunch 12:50 to 1:45. And then hopefully we'll be back on schedule for this afternoon. Okay. You're familiar by now with the format. Our presenter will speak for 20 minutes. Our respondent will get 10 minutes for the response. And then we'll open it up for conversation. Sorry? 30 minutes, I'm sorry. Yeah. Did I say 30? Yeah. Yeah. I just like to scare people, yeah. The three of us, we need to be conscious of those who are watching online. So the three of us who are at the table, we need to use the microphone. And then if you get called on to ask a question, please stand up, give your name. The microphone will be brought to you, and please speak into the microphone, and that will enable those involved in the symposium online to participate also. If you want to ask a question, just raise your hand and try and catch my eye, and I will try and make a list as we go along and do my best to call upon people in order. I think that's about it. We should make a start, but first of all, let's pray. Let's commit our day to the Lord. Father God, we know in our human affairs, circumstances intervene, and sometimes our timings go wrong, but we know that the timing of your Holy Spirit is never wrong, that your Holy Spirit always acts in accordance with your perfect will, the triune God. And so we pray that Holy Spirit would be with us this morning, that this would be the right time in the Spirit's purposes and the Spirit's leading and the Spirit's guiding, and that you would guide us into the Spirit's truth this morning. In Christ's name we ask it, and for his glory. Amen.
Trying to figure out which is the best way to do this. Good morning, everybody. Before anything, I want to kind of express my thanks to the organizing committee and those who invited me to the symposium. I really look forward to the discussion. I want to talk this morning about something that I've been toying with for some time, and so I hope it really comes across in the way I intend it. In this paper, I intend to kind of propose a hermeneutics of absence, and I'm going to define that a little bit later on. But before, let me tell you that I've divided the paper, which I hope you already read, or if you haven't read it, that the discussion today kind of invites you to want to read it. I divided the paper in three sections, and in the first section, pretty much I say a little bit about where hermeneutic has come from, where, you know, how did it form, what happened, and some of the developments that have taken place. In the second section, I engage more the kind of starting from the middle of the 20th century to today, some of the more recent hermeneutical developments that have taken place that I think have contributed to shape and reshape the face of hermeneutics. So in really very broad strokes, let me just tell you briefly what some of the things that I highlight in the first section. And in this first section, really, I take the time to just discuss some of the things that were taken for granted that now, that have, in many ways, have been criticized and pretty much no longer one can affirm so freely. So the first thing is that there was a shared confidence that it was possible to get the meaning of the text, right? Exactly as it was intended by the author. So that was one of the big things that was done. They also insisted on the possibility of objectivity in the interpretive act or in the interpretive task. The third point that I make is just that they promoted the development of abstract theoretical frames, which were then applied to the Bible. And among Bible scholars specifically, there was kind of the application of cutting-edge literary approaches that contributed to kind of learning to tease out material from the biblical text. And of course, coming out right out of the Enlightenment, the application of the scientific method and modern notions of history that were then put against the biblical text. And he turned, hermeneutics turned in many ways as a kind of a fact-finding. And so the miraculous character of the biblical text was kind of taken out. So the results were then that the Bible became not much more than a great piece of literature. And it lost its status as scripture. The stories were challenged and placed under scientific scrutiny. And also the sense of a biblical narrative and salvation history kind of was lost. And where do humans fit into this? We lost our way. How do we fit into salvation history as we are reading the biblical text? But for me, the biggest implication of this kind of endeavor was the radical separation of the actual author and the actual reader from the text. If I take the examples of Ricoeur and Gadamer as two examples, Ricoeur would say that the text is independent, right, from the actual author. And Gadamer would say, well, the reader really, all they have to do is kind of line themselves up with the world or the horizon of the text, right? So in both senses, the actual author, who they are, who they were, and in the reader, the actual reader, who they are and their experiences and their history gets separated from the actual task of interpretation. Of course, much more can be said. Patron-client, honor-shame, reader-response approaches. So there's a lot more that can be said. So that's why I hope you can read the actual paper. But then I move on to the second section of the paper, in which I spent some time just bringing out some of the challenges that these new approaches to hermeneutics bring out. And so let me just list them, because there are only three. And the first thing they emphasize, of course, is that context and social location play a fundamental role in the interpretive moment. I mean, you cannot excise yourself from who you are, from your location, and from your context when you read the text. Two, they affirm that the reality of the readers, that is, and that of the authors, in terms of their own racial background, gender, social status, and history of colonial oppression profoundly impact the way people both read the text, interpret the scripture, and imagine themselves within the gospel story. And so as a result, right, these approaches problematize the interpretive moment and make it really difficult for anyone now, or anyone reading, or anyone interpretation today to kind of claim a monopoly of the reading. Now, interpretation itself is open for interrogation. Right. So let's get to the third section, which is kind of where I want to spend most of my time, or the remainder of my time, of the 30 minutes, not the 20 minutes.
Only 20 left now.
Fair enough. So by hermeneutics of absence, I mean a small shift in our interpretive approach to the Bible. I do not mean really a method as much as a stance of inquiry by which we ask ourselves, what is missing? In this stance, we also ask the Bible about the kinds of issues that are absent in prevailing approaches to hermeneutics, as well as we ask what kinds of issues are in the Bible, but that as of yet have not been dealt or wrestled with by current hermeneutics. So what I'm trying to do in this hermeneutics of absence is to problematize the reading of the Bible by asking why our readings of the Bible are so sanitized. So these are kind of the questions, four questions guiding my thoughts. One, why do our readings of the Bible not often deal with the human struggle of racialized differences and the uncertainty and destructive power of human evil because of racism? That's the first one. The second one is it possible that the question of racialization, of racism and ethnocultural discrimination are absent from the Bible? Is it possible? Or let me say it differently. Is race a significant factor in the Bible? I think it is. So let me just put that out. So if it is, then how do ethnocultural differences find themselves expressed in the text? And so my fourth question is this. Then, so how does engaging issues of racism and racialized differences help us to understand the God of the Bible? Right? Because at the end of the day, this is what we're asking. So in the paper, I grabbed six examples, right, and analyzed them to show how it is that the question of race, because that's what the theme, the chosen theme for this symposium is. How do they discuss questions of race? The first example that I talk about is the case of Jephthah in Judges 12, the shibboleth. The story of Ruth. The case of endogamy in Nehemiah and Ezra. So those in the Hebrew Bible or Old Testament, depending on how you choose to identify it. And in the New Testament, I discuss the encounter between Jesus and the Samaritan woman, Jesus' encounter with the Syrophoenician woman in Mark 7, and Peter at the house of Cornelius. Now, I revisit these quite popular passages to show how the dynamics of race, racialization, ethnic identity, and culture appear in the biblical text. I highlight the ethnocentric character of many of the stories and show how Israel's racialized exclusionary tendencies were often filtered through their own theological ethno-racial self-perception. So in other words, I uncover, and this is my word, how cultural and racialized identity intersects with the religious dimensions of the text itself, which I believe can shed light on current issues. So for the purpose of this discussion, let me take two of those examples and just run through them very quickly before I run out of time, and then see what happens. Is that okay? The two examples that I decided to take were, one, the question of endogamy, the not marrying foreign women or not marrying with foreigners in Ezra and Nehemiah. And the other example is that of Cornelius, Peter at the house of Cornelius. And I want to say that in the case of Ezra and Nehemiah, what we find is the racialized prejudices and racialized culture are woven with religious overtones. So the book of Ezra 9:10 and Nehemiah chapter 13 record incidents related to the mixed marriages. We all know that, I hope. And if not, now you know, right? Now, a surface reading, right, can easily condemn the passages as condoning xenophobia. Now, that would be the immediate reaction. But we know that Ruth, Rahab, and foreigners were welcome among the people of Israel. So then we have to ask a question. So what is going on then? Right. Now, it's generally known that these two books, contain the record of the painstaking experience of the people of Israel of rebuilding the city of Jerusalem by those Israelites who had returned from exile, right? That's usually how we look at it. So there are enormous commonalities between the two books. Both mention radical measures towards endogamy. Both connect mixed marriages to the larger concern of idolatry of other nations. And both highlight Israel's sin of unfaithfulness through marriage to foreign women. But there are also critical differences as well. In Nehemiah, it is unclear what will happen with those who marry foreign women, but the taboo is still made clear. But in Ezra, those who married foreign women are forced to separate from them. In Nehemiah, the prior rejection of intermarriage with the Ammonites and the Moabites' cousins, that is Lot's daughter, you will recall, is connected to their culture's old unwelcoming attitude. Remember, Ruth was a Moabite. In Ezra, it is because they had been, quote, set apart. So there are two very different reasons why. In Nehemiah, the responsibility for purity falls upon the Levites, who are instructed to purify themselves of everything foreign. Yet the book comes to an abrupt ending, which is kind of leaves you, okay, so what happened? Curiously, though, Nehemiah centers on the intersection between the holy character of the people of Israel as being set apart over against implicit other cultural children. Now, this is important because it is that which threatens the people of Israel for Nehemiah. Nehemiah was enraged. Now, this is a fascinating issue today even. Nehemiah was enraged when he discovered that half of the children of Judah, quote, spoke the language of Ashdod or the language of one of the other people, but did not know how to speak the language of Judah. Talk about not speaking English here. So idolatry then plays a secondary role for him. The allusion to Solomon also is part of how this is supported, but it appears in a secondary way. But meanwhile, in Ezra, marriage with other people is perceived not as a threat in terms of biological, racialized features, but through potentially irreconcilable cultural and religious differences. The leaders are said to be the ones that came to him and said, the people of Israel, including the priests, note, and the Levites, have not kept themselves separate from their neighboring peoples with their detestable practices, which I assume is idolatry, at least one of them. So for Ezra, the racialized cultural and religious are so intertwined that intermarriage could potentially signify the eventual undermining of the people's own existence, the existence of their own ethnocultural traditions and religious imaginary. So the linguistic cultural element symbolized for Nehemiah religious faith and extreme religious zeal. But for him, the Levitical rules are expectations for the Levite priest alone. But for Ezra, who is a bit more of an extremist, he conflates them, he conflates these notions of holiness and apply them to all of Israel. For him, the personal lives of the entire people of Israel are to be regulated by the principles of holiness in the fashion that was required only from the priests. See where I'm getting? Now, there is a theological underpinning. The status of Israel as holy people operates as the motivation for avoiding intermarriage. That goes as far back as Deuteronomy chapter 7, verse 3 and 4. Or any alliances with the nations. The implication is such that by turning away from Yahweh and serving the other gods of the other nations, Israel would compromise its holy status. So in the case of Ezra and Nehemiah, the incident of endogamy, we see that the notion of holiness is interpreted as bearing cultural, racialized, and religious elements. In Israel, I mean, as Israel wrestled with what it meant to be an Israelite, or as part of the holy people, the construction of racialized ethnic and cultural boundaries became necessary. Stated another way, the deeply theological meaning of Israel as the holy people received its concrete expression in the creation of ethnocentric racialized cultural boundaries as markers to distinguish them from the other groups. So let me then continue. I have to be careful not to construe the incident as a kind of a modern expression of xenophobia as we understand it today. we ought to be careful not to be anachronistic in terms of viewing this as an expression of racism, as in the modern sense. At the same time, Ezra and Nehemiah, their incident of endogamy, can serve us, modern readers, as a cautionary tale of the potentially exclusionary perils of nationalist, ethno-racial, and cultural identity. So the concern about miscegenation and exogamy with neighboring groups relates to the perceived long-standing differences between returning migrants and those who remain in the land. Thus, the attitudes of cultural and racialized xenophobia in the text expose the nexus between the desire to reclaim their sense of identity as people, to safeguard their cultural traditions, and to bring some kind of healing to the emotional trauma or memory of historical exile, embodied in those returning and embodied in those who stayed and mixed with the enemy. So the question here is for the mixed children, because the mixed children are the memory, both of the exile and of the trauma. So let me leave it there. At the same time, then, Ezra Nehemiah passage puts on display Israel's own ethnocentrism and racialized cultural prejudices towards other groups on the basis of their theology. For our purposes, the Ezra Nehemiah crisis of intermarriage displays yet another example of the protracted process of the construction of ethnic and cultural identities for Israel. The intention here, then, for me, as I'm talking to you, is not either condemned or condone the events described. That's not what I'm intending to do. Rather, it is to elucidate how the intimate interconnectedness between the religious, the racialized, and the cultural symbols play out in the actual account, and how these are negotiated within a contested space and notions of faith in Yahweh. And most importantly, how people express their devotion to God. So let me now hurry up and go to the second example, and I'm gonna go a bit faster with this one because it's shorter. Peter of the house of Cornelius. I wanna say that this passage is kind of the other side of the incident of Ezra and Nehemiah. The incident is really brief in the book of Acts, but it has enormous implications for the early church. The story, as you probably know, is framed around the issues of impurity and uncleanness, most likely highlighting how the Israelites viewed themselves in relation to the other groups, right? Remember that when Peter went and reported it, the question was, so Peter went up to Jerusalem, the circumcised went very quickly, those Jewish who were circumcised went and criticized them for doing that. So there is this tension. What I want to propose to you is that the fundamental question in the passage is food. In both Peter's visions and Cornelius' home, you enter into somebody else's house to share a meal with that person. So the playful intersection between racialized cultural and ethnic differences and the resulting tensions center around eating, okay? So this is what's happening. So we are dealing then with the sociocultural dynamics, so hear this, sociocultural dynamics of racialization of food, meals, and table fellowship. We do it differently, and we do it with different people. The effect of the encounter is that Peter's own and the Christian Jewish inherent understanding of cleanness and purity is put into question. And this is summarized by Peter's own response. I have never eaten anything impure or unclean. Right. So Peter's experience at the house of Cornelius causes him and his Jewish companions, that is, their claims to ethnic, cultural, and religious exclusivity to collapse. and force them to fundamentally rethink their own sense of divine chosenness. And this is also summarized in 10:45, where it says, the circumcised believers who had come with Peter were astonished that the gift of the Spirit had been poured out even on the Gentiles. I mean, this is unbelievable. How could this happen? So the theological implications are enormous. God has now granted the Gentiles not only repentance unto life, but also the fullness of the Holy Spirit in full acceptance into the household of God as first-class citizens. That's the shift that the passage shows. So if I say it another way, is the event conveys the leveling of the playing field. By Peter entering, and this is what I really like. This is one of those things. By Peter entering the house of Cornelius, Luke, the author, no longer regards Gentile homes as unclean and off limits for Jewish Christians. In fact, Gentile homes are sites of divine manifestation of the Spirit. I mean, that's an amazing shift that is happening here. Now, view from the perspective of racialized ethnocultural frameworks, the incident between Peter and Cornelius and his household serve as an object lesson of the radical social, ideological, dietary, architectural, and cultural changes that all ethnocultural traditions often need to undergo as they begin to make room for the others or for the outsiders, and how those changes are also theologically informed. So theology is not hanging out here that you can bracket it out. You have to pay attention to the theology of racism. Where is it coming from and how is that being informed? So the encounter between Peter and Cornelius is also important because the Spirit is said to be poured out on all present in the house of Cornelius, despite the fact that there is no record that he or those present ever adopted Judaism. So the Jerusalem Council in Acts 15, it's only a formality. The Spirit had already done the deal. So Peter himself in Acts 11:17 testifies that the incident at the house of Cornelius made him realize that he and the other followers of Jesus needed to rethink their own theological notions of distinction and separation they had inherited. Their theology had to be, and I want to underscore this, their theology had to be unhinged from its early ethnocentric and racialized perspectives. So if God gave them the gift, as it's been given to us, who believe in the Lord Jesus Christ, who are we, asks Peter. Who are we, or who am I, he says, who am I to think that I could oppose God? So the book of Acts provides for crucial insights as to how Jewish, racialized, ethnocultural, and ethno and religious perceptions of Gentiles were being fundamentally transformed even as Christianity was being born. So let me close with 4 points very quickly because I ran out of time. By using a hermeneutics of absence, I cannot avoid then anymore talking about the experience of faith in God without engaging issues of racial, ethnic, and cultural background and dynamics. Questions of inter-ethnic, inter-racial relations have impacted all of human history, and the biblical text is no exception. Adopting a hermeneutics of absence, then I show that the issues of race, racialization, experience of racism, and all other forms of discrimination shape the way people read the Bible, and also the way the Bible was written. Now, in the midst of a current climate of evident racialized violence directed to African Americans, racialized criminalization of Latin American immigrants and Latinos and Latinas, and racialized cultural destruction of Native Americans and First Nations, the racialized stereotypical assumptions about Muslims as terrorists, and Asians in the waning of Asians as honorary whites, the single most important message that I want to leave to you is that a hermeneutics of absence is the celebration and a struggle for the sacredness of the life of the racialized, discriminated other. This, in my view, is the mandate of the Spirit, that the Spirit places among us. And it is among them, very strongly, it is among them, in their struggle for life, that the Spirit of God is being manifest in the kingdom of God. Thank you.
I feel like Dr. Medina has generated an ocean, and I'm about to jump into the middle of it without a life preserver. Having said that, I entitled my response, Engaging a Hermeneutic of Absence, Can We Read the Biblical Text Together? A couple of passages to be noted. And I have other sheep that are not of this fold. I must bring them also. And they will listen to my voice, so there will be one flock, one shepherd. John 10:16. I therefore, a prisoner for the Lord, urge you to walk in a manner worthy of the calling to which you have been called, with all humility and gentleness and patience, bearing one another in love, eager to maintain the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. Ephesians 4:1-3. The passage above affirmed the biblical priority of unity in the church, not just in terms of common confession, but love for one another. Among the many contributions that Dr. Medina's work makes to a discussion on hermeneutics, there is a contribution of an awareness of the possible establishment and maintenance of positions of power in any seemingly harmless human encounter. Appeals to unity may indeed cloak such an establishment and maintenance. Calls to unity, though they can be abused, can never be ignored simply because of the danger of abuse. Movement towards unity can be applied to discussions, emergent methodologies, and applications in the realm of hermeneutics, here with a focus on the biblical text. Medina appropriately has his own objectives in the production of his work, concisely summarized in a call for entering, quote, the text narrative, close quote, with the sensitivities aroused by the named stories and the unique epistemological sources of various interpretive communities. The uniqueness of various interpretive communities must be respected in the hermeneutical project, if for no other reason than to facilitate blessing arising from the mutual sharing of understandings and applications from the biblical text. Like Medina, my purpose in this response is not to construct the hermeneutical method. He has offered a multitude of determinative observations and analyses in this paper. I can comment, however, on only a few things. I will first identify some of Medina's reminders and challenges in the sphere of hermeneutics. I will then offer some cautions and questions in light of aspects of his thought. My overarching hope is that we learn and incorporate relevant elements of his thought to move us to greater authenticity and transformative power as we engage the biblical text. My cautions and questions concurrently arise from the burden for unity, whereby we respect the uniqueness of various hermeneutical communities, but we are also enabled to remember through the text the instructions, the confessions, and the needed correctives to our communities that can empower us to be one. It was extremely helpful to have some exposure to the thought of people who have shaped Much of the discussion in the previous dominant culture of hermeneutics, I found discussions on such people as Hans Georg Gadamer and Paul Ricoeur very informative. I resonated, however, with Medina's summary concerning these and others who put so much confidence in their rational capacities for the hermeneutical project, while concurrently demonstrating a lack of awareness of their own socio-cultural situatedness while formulating their thought. The threefold impact of modernism and Michel Foucault's understanding of the conditioning power of knowledge propagated in various social contexts and readings of scripture itself set the stage well for discussing the decentralizing impact on such dominant discussions by emergent interpreters from communities previously unrecognized or insufficiently engaged. I was intrigued and encouraged by the knowledge that after two world wars, there were countries in the global south, as well as in Africa and Asia, who were engaged in, quote, engaged in systemic anti-colonial movements with profound political, economic, and cultural implications, close quote. The rise of liberation, black, feminist, and womanist theological constructs, along with various anti-colonial movements, would have enormous impact not only on social-political relationships in various settings, but also on the church, on theological reflection, and particularly on the reading and interpretation of scripture. These interpretive communities alert readers to such realities as there are no neutral readings of scripture. The presence of racial, ethnic dynamics in the text, power relationships, and the molding and shifting dimensions of identity. I was both grateful and challenged by many aspects of Dr. Medina's work, but I was particularly grateful for the, quote, permission to plumb the depths of my own black church heritage, seeking further transformative engagements with scripture leading to deeper communion with my Lord through the text. I do, however, still have some cautions and questions regarding his hermeneutical absence project. The first is the probing for a heightened specificity on what is missing in hermeneutical discussions. Second, I want to briefly comment on the significance of an example of social cultural blindness manifest in the scriptures. What I'm getting at there is, yes, we do have these kinds of factors that we have to take in consideration as we engage the text, but we want to make sure that we hear the text as well. Finally, the sensitivities arising from anti-colonial readings of scripture should still consider the contributions of intertextual readings within the scriptures. I will revisit Jesus' encounter with the Samaritan woman in John 4 to address this potentiality. Is there a dominant understanding that should be associated with the meaning of missing in interpretive process? Should we focus more on what we are missing in hermeneutical discussions? Or should we focus on what we be missing in the text itself? For example, a consideration of the narrative of the Lord's Supper is one thing to say that dominant hermeneutical discussions miss some points of meaning and application. It is another to suggest that something is missing in the text, calling for the insertion of some creative formulation. It may be beneficial to consider the perspective of food preparers and servers, but do we have access to this perspective? The absence of women's names in the totality of scripture could indeed reveal underlying patriarchal tendencies in the socio-cultural fabric of the biblical writers. Though this is a legitimate observation to bring to the biblical text, I would raise another consideration. Where women's names are recorded, are they and the contextual surroundings significant? The number of times something appears or does not appear in scripture can be an exegetical marker of significance. Sometimes that which does not have numerous references may still have great importance attributed hermeneutically, even with fewer instances. Many examples could be cited, such as Sarah, Deborah, Mary, the mother of Jesus. One can bring to such reflections the meaning of Hagar, from Galatians 4, 24 to 25, as in the case of womanist theologian Dolores Williams. Mm-hmm. These can indeed be fleshed out. Finally, a post-colonial reading of Jesus' meeting with the Samaritan woman in John can yield some interesting insights, as Medina demonstrates. along with lessons learned from a consideration of Samaritans who are, quote, who are Jews but not completely, close quote, and comparisons with situations of mixed blood people, there are still, nevertheless, further gleanings that can arise from considerations of intertextuality that can enhance the understanding of this encounter. From 2 Kings 17, for example, we learned that the northern tribes were repeatedly warned of judgment for covenant violations, and they did not listen. They were exiled to Syria, and other people groups were moved into the area by the Assyrians. They worshiped God, but they also worshiped the gods of their previous lands, even burning their children in sacrifice. Verse 31 of 2 Kings 17. The final verse in 2 Kings 17, verse 44, reads, "So these nations feared the Lord and also served their carved images. Their children did likewise, and their children's children, as their fathers did. So they do to this day." Now, don't ask me what all that means. I'm just saying this is what the passage says. The attitude of the Jewish people in Jesus' day toward the Samaritans had become sin-infested and deplorable. But there were still lessons to be learned from the Old Testament background concerning the consequences of covenant unfaithfulness that contributed to the reported hostility in John 4. Medina's hermeneutical project succeeds in establishing a stance of inquiry for our purposes. I hope for future hermeneutical discussions that respect for racial, ethnic, gender, and geographical uniqueness of participants is a part of the study of the scriptures. There is so much that can be contributed to one another. May we listen to streams of diversity in biblical dialogue while maintaining a movement toward agreement on the message of the text. May the church live with authenticity in the sphere of one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all, who is over all and through all and in all. Thank you.
As always, our presenter gets the first right of response.
Okay. There's a lot. Thank you. There's a lot. But let me just touch on two points. The first one is in terms of what's missing. And I intended it as a invitation, right? The issue is that we do have, we all are trained, or at least let me not make generalizations, many of us are trained or were trained in the traditional approaches to hermeneutics. And in those traditional approaches to hermeneutics, there is a great deal that is absent, that is missing. Not daring to ask the question, what is missing, may just guide us to just repeat and reproduce what we inherited. And so while it's an attitude, an invitation, it is also an attitude of interrogation. Is it possible that everything that is in the biblical text has been already addressed or dealt with? So I have yet to hear, for example, a preacher that stands on a pulpit and discusses Ezra and Nehemiah, drawing on ethno-racial cultural issues. It is possible that it may be because it is so incredibly charged a subject. But I have yet to hear it. You probably have, but I haven't. So in that sense, I am not intending to prescribe what is missing, as much as opening the text and say, what do you want to tell me? And what is it that you tell me that is there that has immediate implication with the way things are today? So the example of Jephthah and the Shibboleth and the 40,000 that were killed because they had an accent has enormous implications for today, for the way people are looked at because of the way they speak English. So I think we need to, that is where I was going with the notion of what's missing, an invitation but both an interrogation, daring to ask the question, even though you possibly are jumping into the deep end, you know, like that, this is a big issue, right? And the second one, I just, when you said, well, yes, the context of Jesus was a kind of a sin infected, right? Yes, infested. Yes, absolutely. But you have to also take seriously Jesus' own behavior. Jesus is the one that ate with the tax collectors, with the prostitutes, the very people that were discriminated against and excluded, right? So yes, Jesus didn't just go in and say, well, you know, all of you deserve to go to hell. His intention was actually to change the structures of a system that left them out. And so I think that also needs to be taken into consideration. So let me just say that, and because I've spoken too much already. So. Mm-hmm.
Dr. Fields, do you want to add anything at this stage?
I just wanted to say that I concur with many of the concerns that Dr. Medina sets forth. The thing that I am probably most concerned about is that in the call for relevance, in the call for authentic engagement with the text, what brings us together? Right. We want to do respect to all the issues and seek to be relevant, to speak to real issues of the day. But I'm just saying that as well, that the concern is, do we allow the text to speak to our understanding even of the day? And how do we engage one another in that realm as well? So by all means, I agree with much what is going on.
Okay, let's open it up for questions. Yeah, Larry. Okay, we'll need to bring you a microphone. Yeah. Could you do that, Michelle? Yeah, thank you.
Larry Camphausen, I am an Abba in the Ecumenical Religious Order of Jesus Christ Reconciler, and as Abba, I pastor a local worshiping community called the Oratory of Jesus Christ Reconciler. I guess my question is about an absence that I've been observing, especially recently, around white responses to Black Lives Matter and the racialized violence around policing. And it is that that they are not admitting that there is some distance between white structural racism that we know and the issues of racism, or is it racism? I don't know. Ethnocentrism that you pointed out in the scriptures. I have the question, is that ethnocentrism and religious exclusivism that we find in the biblical texts the same or even analogous to white racism that includes the creation of whiteness out of a flattening of European cultural identity? And on top of that, creating an ontological hierarchy of being based on color with this, you know, spectrum from white to black that was and still is enforced by political, military, and economic power and dominance and religious ideology. So what do you do with that absence in your hermeneutic?
You noted it? I mean, I'm not trying to be trivial, but you definitely noted. But I think we have to make a decision. This is why I was trying to say that we have to be very careful between the reading of the text, what is in the text, and not say, so here, there are examples of xenophobia in the modern term, because then we're being anachronistic about the text, right? So that's I'm really guarding against. At the same time, we have to think that the whole notion of whiteness has had its own history, right? There was a point in time when Italians and Irish people were not white. So then what we really have to dismount or dismantle, interrogate, is this notion of whiteness, right? Because even we have white trash. So we have to really think about what it is that we mean by the use of the category. On the other hand, I want to be careful to not be trapped by the black-white binary. Because the black-white binary, on one hand, erases everybody else who is from a different cultural tradition, i.e. Latinos and Native Americans. Totally. It makes them absent, okay? And on the other hand, it's a whole question of where is this going, right? Is it possible that the binary black-white is but a mechanism of population control, because otherwise we could not deal with the complexity of the myriad mosaic that we face, right? Because if they then have to face what Latinos and Latinas are saying, if they then face what Asians and going back to your idea that flattening of African, of white identities, where when we say blacks or African Americans, we're also flattening because they're incredibly diverse. Latinos and Latinas are also incredibly diverse. Asians, my goodness. So we need to really interrogate even those categories that we use, because they're also part of the problem. And so I think part of their absence is the inability to wrestle with such a complex issue that anything they say inevitably is gonna come out like they're a bunch of idiots. And forgive me to use that word. So that's why.
Joel Willits, North Park University. Along the lines you were just talking about, I wonder if we flattened our understanding of Jewish ethnicity in the scripture. Even in your discussion of Cornelius and the discussion of Ezra and Nehemiah, it seems to me that there was an absence of an appreciation for the diversity. Say in the Cornelius incident, you know, the word, it's unlawful in that text isn't actually namas, it's more like a taboo. Mm-hmm. Than it is related to some Torah command. So it seems that there was some halakhic development from the Torah that at least a group of Jews, particularly it appears around Jerusalem, had defined to a extent farther than the Torah had legislated about what it meant to be in close social intercourse with a Gentile. Because in the diaspora, it's a whole different ball game, and we have different evidence to suggest that intercourse was much more common. So I find that sometimes the issue of that would make our conversations about modern issues could be helped by a better understanding of the Jewish world of Jesus and the apostles, and even in the time of Ezra and Nehemiah. And I just wonder if you've thought about that, or if you would reflect on our re-ethnicizing the scripture. Because it seems like we've de-ethnicized it, flattened things, and anyway, so there's a number of things you could address, but wanted to throw that out.
Well, yes, there are a number of things. But let me just say this: one, I really would have to pay greater attention to the dynamics of how these differences are marked in the text, and I haven't yet done that. At the same time. We also need to understand that the de-emphasizing of the ethnicity of the Jews has also a historic pointing to where it's coming from, right? I mean, so there is a sense in which when the Jews were in among the Muslims in the Iberian Peninsula, when they were under Muslims during the Middle Ages, they needed to have a sense of who they are, and there were these broad strokes in order to have control of them. So instead of doing that, then they started calling them either conversos or, and in other places, marranos. So, but it was an intentionality to de-emphasize it in order to be able to coexist in the context or under the the control of the Muslim government, right? After the 1492, when the Spanish finally win the war, and they deport, they not only deport Jews, they also deport Muslims. And so that we don't often hear about. The same thing goes with the category of Semitism. And if you are against Jewish, you are an anti-Semite. But if you're an anti-Arab, you're not anti-Semite. Well, actually, no. Arabs are also Semites, you see. So I think there is a whole lot of things that need to, but more specifically about the text. It'd be amazing to investigate this and to study it. I suspect, too, that the incident with Cornelius might be that it's moving in the direction that you're saying, but it can also be that this was so commonsensical that there was no law that needed to make, but it became a taboo because it's just simply, we don't do it, right? Right. And so I don't know well enough to know how the Jews behaved, say, when they were deported in Rome, say. But we need to pay attention also to, I would say, to the kind of the pushback that the Apostle Paul experienced when he's talking about the gospel to the Gentiles. And he's getting this, a lot of rap for it. So I think there is a whole lot of things that need to, but yeah. Anyway, I know I'm not answering your question, but yeah.
Look.
Thank you so much for this paper. I know I'll be putting it in front of students in important ways. And I think I wanna just enter into the discourse that these two questioners are raising. I think one of the things that's so helpful about this project, and I'm so glad to have an ally in it, is to reflect on the nature of ethnic tension as it exists in the text, yeah. Right? So I think that's the big project you're engaged in, and I think that's a really helpful project. The one criticism I'd like to offer has to do with, I think, something else that was raised. There's a difference between saying there's no ethnicity or racism in the text and saying that the nature of the ethnicity and racism in the text is the same as what we have today.
Mm-hmm.
And there is you have a tendency in the paper, I think, to use terms synonymously in modern terms that are slightly different. The one that caught my eye a lot was the way that you equate ethnocentrism and racism. I actually think those are quite different. I think it's analogous to the difference between prejudice and racism, mm-hmm. right? Everyone's prejudiced, but not everyone's racist, because there's a certain amount of like capacity for oppression
sure.
that has to accompany the prejudice in order to turn it to racism. Sure. So that'd be the one thing that I would hope that you could address.
Absolutely.
And thank you so much. This was a great one. If I could ask a question of Dr. Fields as well. Dr. Fields, I also heard your burden for wanting to say, you know, it's important to talk about difference, but how about unity too? And I think I have that same kind of conflict in my own work. But one of the places where that tension in myself most emerges is that and you can't do everything in 10 minutes or, you know, in every paper, but I just would like to hear you reflect on this tension. And that is sometimes the emphasis on unity can promote this phenomena of colorblindness. And so I wonder if you would address that.
I thought I was done. All right. The questions you raised, Dr. Seacrest, are important. I'd certainly wanted to defer to Dr. Medina in his response. But in this struggle, as we engage our particularity and seek to wrestle legitimately with the particularity of the biblical texts, the authors, the social, cultural background, the political realities, all these types of issues that we have to consider to hopefully arrive at the meaning of the text and subsequent applications. Is there an accompanying awareness that there are certain things that identify me as Christian? Beliefs, confessions of, I know this is not necessarily popular in these days, but of a transcendent nature whereby you could indeed have a person from an Asian context, an African-American context, a South African context, and they're all coming to the text and they're all seeking to build their theological constructs and apply them to their settings. But do we have an accompanying awareness that there are some things that identify us as one, as a, to use another term, as members of the people of God? In the discussions of particularity that are needed, mutually informing, mutually contributing, do we also demonstrate an awareness of our unity? That's a major concern of mine. And in that context as well, let me just mention one other thing, something that has not been discussed, and Dr. Medina, I wanted to be certainly respectful to the overall flow of your work and only comment within that framework. But in one of the concerns I have is that, does the state of my heart affect what I see in Scripture? If I have distrust, if I have anger, if I have hatred, if I have resentment, does that impact what I see and what I don't see and what I apply and don't apply? And sometimes it's the recollection of who we are in commonality that confront my own internal workings. So particularity, yes. Awareness of what makes us the church, what makes us Christian, what makes us members of the body of Christ. Do we hold them together?
I tremble when I hear emphasis on unity, because it often is used as an antidote to not raise these critical issues. And let me go back to something you said last night, if I may, Dr. Seifert. You said, we all are mixed. And I want to say, well, that's another kind of saying, we all are united in the Lord, because not all mixtures are created equal. You will have the Latino with a European who is white skinned, who very quickly pass as white. You will have the Latino that looks like me, that has difficulties even getting a job. So the ability to see how all these issues inform people's, even people's decisions, is an important point. And going back to the question of the heart, the condition of the heart, I want to say yes. But I am sad and oppressed because there is an entire system that saddens me and oppresses me and hurts me. To be able to not take the affirmation of the condition of the heart within its own context and the very circumstances that allow and cause that very hurtfulness would be a disservice to seeking the unity in God. So that's all I'm going to say.
Rachel.
My name is Rachel Burgoyne. I'm in my last year as an MDiv student here and in the nonprofit degree as well. My question, I'll try to keep it concise because it's still kind of processing, but who are you inviting primarily to use this hermeneutics of absence Is it to the academy? Is it to the larger church? And could it be used almost as an invitation to those outside the church who have qualms about scripture? I'll get a little more into that. As a generalization in the church, we assume that scripture has some good ends to it, so we're not as critical about certain texts maybe we should be. In the academy, not quite the same, but in the larger church, I think we do assume that the scripture is trying to bring us somewhere good. Outside the church, I don't think that assumption is there as much. I have friends who think the Bible is just racist and sexist, or have propped up those systems. And so can this hermeneutics of absence be used almost to bring other people in, maybe, who already see what's not there? And yeah, it's a question.
I would want to say it differently, but absolutely. But I would want to say that the people who are not in the church see some things, but they also need help to see the other things that we see. So it's not like they have the picture together. Otherwise, chances are they would be Christians, but this is my bias. So yes, it's an invitation to anyone and everyone. It's daring to engage the text. For those inside the church, it's also a call for honesty. The biblical text is messy. It's complicated. It has all these many manifestations that we today seem to want to condone but don't want to accept in the biblical text. And to me, it's just a call to say, just accept it. It's there, right? But then that should hopefully elicit someone or desire for conversation, which I think that's part of the reason that conversation is not taking place in our churches. So,
next there was a hand behind Rachel and then Kelly.
Hi, my name is Tim Marie. I'm a Master's of Divinity student here at North Park. My question was with regards to method. I know that you mentioned in the paper that's not what you wish to accomplish or address, but I was wondering if you could perhaps point us in a direction with regards to sources or avenues through which we could explore the hermeneutics of absence, because you also address the very fact that every single one of us, we have our presuppositions, we all have our cultural lenses through which we view scripture, and as I was reflecting on that, and you urge us to ask the questions like what's missing and what's not there, but the very questions that I would ask would be asked through my cultural presuppositions.
Right.
And so I'm wondering if there is any resources, books, articles, or even maybe questions that you've come up with that may have less bias that you can use as an avenue through which you can explore these texts.
I want to say there's a sea of resources. But this thing of hermeneutics of absence, this is the first time I actually dare to put it out. I've been holding it for like a couple of years, 2-3 years, and I've been playing with it, and I've mentioned it here and there in conferences, but I haven't really dared to put it out because it's still in the oven. And also because I don't want to propose a method. I'm just making an invitation. I think the academia is so caught up in providing methods instead of just sitting down and actually getting at the text. And so that's part of the other thing is, I don't think there are people who can read the text with less presuppositions. I think there are people who read the text more aware of their presuppositions and they put them in check. And so that's the only comment that I would want to. But there is a sea of material.
Okay, Kelly.
You don't have a question?
Oh, sorry, I thought I saw your hand earlier. Yeah,
I had a question.
Yeah.
I was raising my hand.
Yeah.
Like this.
Okay. Oh, I see.
Sing Chan Ra here at North Park. I actually want to pick up a thread that Dr. Willits referenced, and this idea of presuppositions as well, that is there a presupposition of whiteness as comparative to Jewishness, and that there is a reading that comes, so like when you're saying about absence, Is there an assumption that, Europeans, those of European descent, can read themselves into texts in the place of Jewishness? I can see myself in the place of Paul. I can see myself even in the place of Jesus. And then in turn, out of that kind of graciousness to say, well, isn't it great that we're now accepting Cornelius and that's everybody else? When actually, we're all Cornelius. We're all Gentiles. And that's where Dr. Jennings talks about this Gentile existence of all of us who are Christians, we're Gentiles. And so is there kind of a problem with the hermeneutic, not the hermeneutic of absence, but the kind of the assumption that a certain culture already sees themselves in the text in ways that are inappropriate, and that maybe that's kind of a hermeneutic that needs to be addressed as well, that the assumption of whiteness as comparative to Jewishness?
I want to say no, but it is possible that in my own subconscious level, part of the reason why I want to say no is because what I'm doing is just simply say, this is what I've been taught. This is what I was told I should do when I read the text. These are the ways, right? I mean, and I'm giving the particular canon of texts and authors that I should use to read and be familiar with and then learn to apply it onto the text. I am just asking the question, so what's missing? Is it possible that these canon of authors didn't really have it all together? Is it possible that they have something that they couldn't see? Are there any blinders that they had, or did they have any blinders? And so when I allow myself to ask that question, I am doing the one thing that you did say, and that is interrogating the very hermeneutic. But that's not my purpose. My purpose is simply to open the envelope so that we can ask the question. Once you ask the question, there's a point of no return. Because then you realize that there's a host of things that we were taught that now are really need to be put into question. And so that's where how I get at it. So I kind of get at it from the back door, so to speak.
Thank you, Dr. Medina and Dr. Fields, for your presentations. I wanted to pick up on perhaps a suggestion of Dr. Fields and ask a question of Dr. Medina, actually. I appreciate how you, among other things, in your selection of the six exemplar texts, you pointed to issues of particularly human authorship and particular instances in the course of redemptive history. I wondered if you can talk a little bit about in what sense you see scripture as divine authorial discourse, at what level. I'm asking this partly because I think I see in the way that you related, for instance, even the Acts 11 narrative of Peter and Cornelius to the Christian faith and to the person of Christ. I think I see implicit in it a sense of an understanding that particular texts ultimately need to be read within the, I don't want to be putting words in your mouth, but here I'm wondering, this is the way that I'm listening and thinking about your very helpful and incisive questions. Is there a sense in which particular texts in the course of redemptive history unfolded in the canon need to be read in the light of a canonical whole as well in order to understand why any particular text, which is more, it's more descriptive of the actual reality of human fallenness being in the course of being redeemed. Where is the coherence, I think, and is there any sense in which these texts can become normative and are not merely human constructions, attempts to self-justify, to secure the self-interest of particular ethno and cultural and religious communities?
OK.
Okay. Actually, couldn't get any better. I think we need to be careful to almost suggest that our tradition is not a human construction at any point. That is to say, right from the moment of the text being written,
of course,
we need to understand, I think, that as the author is writing, they have no idea that what they're writing is a scripture. They are recording the material, but they really have no idea where this is going to end. They're following the guidance. I want to trust in that. But this is part of the reason, I think, why the text is so incredibly human.
Absolutely.
And I think we need to honor that, because at times it's possible that we read the Bible as if it is a kind of a, we take a docetic approach to the Bible, that is, it was inspired right from heaven, came down, and it was never impacted by humanity. What are we talking about here? And so right from there to the termination of the canon, to the termination of the Reformation, what we find normative has been questioned, ridiculed, challenged, interrogated, and imposed. So I think, for me, I think I really need to take a very humble position to say that we're confronted with such a monumental task that I really have to trust in the work of the Spirit along the way. So if there is an authorial power to it, it's the belief that the Spirit is at work in all this messiness, and that in spite of the human character that tends to mess things up, the Spirit is still works and operates, and the Bible is still, when we read it, confront us with the truth of the hope for life. So that is as much as I can say. I mean, there's a whole lot more that I can tell you about the formation of the canon, how Constantine was messing things up in Nicaea in 325. I mean, I can tell you all of that. And then in the process, you kind of lose respect for what you have, right? But at some point, and this is where I like to recur, you have to go back to a second naivety. It's a second appreciation of the multi-dimensional character of this text, that it is so fraught with issues, but it still talks to me and provides me hope. So that's my best way I can answer your question. And probably I'm not even touching the surface. So forgive me for it.
Thank you. We'll talk further.
Okay. Cheryl.
My name is Sherilyn Kane, and perhaps there's others in this situation, but I'm coming to seminary as a practitioner, so I'm always thinking through these things of like ground level and in our churches and how does this operate. So I'm wrestling with kind of even the structure of the church, right, and how we have this like pastoral model where we're really only hearing from a person with their lens week after week after week. So could we speak to how do we create an environment, even within the structure of local church, that invites imagination more than just personal imagination, because I'm thinking about like that Ignatian spirituality of I'm bringing my personal imagination to the text, but like more communal imagination. And and also struggling with that idea of unity stifling perhaps that imagination. I don't know. I'm just thinking of how does that work out in our local church structure.
I imagine that it works out in various different ways. And the last thing I would want to do is prescribe how I would.
I will say, however, that gone are the days of a pastor-centric churches. The people, the issues are so complex today that not one person can possibly, I don't think they ever could, but not one person can today possibly address all the issues and complexities. And so learning to draw on the available resources in the church is a good opportunity to begin to ask some of these questions. But that is something that each church will have to address according to their own context, questions, issues, concerns, circumstances, and so on and so forth, which I am not prepared or equipped to suggest. So that's all I could say. Sorry.
One of the things, you know, I'm sorry to if I appear to be too quick to suppress distinctions, differences, and the like. It's not my intent. But take, for example, the question of how we would try to make this work in a church setting, when I think the fundamental things you have to keep in mind is that it will work imperfectly. All right? We bring our humanity to our faith. We bring our humanity to the church, with its leadership, with its structure. We would like to have respect demonstrated to all backgrounds, racial ethnicities, and the like. But as to use the term that Dr. Medina just said, this is all still very, very, very messy. Family is messy. You've got individuals, yet you've got commonality. And if you approach this search, the search, the hunt for respect for individuality while having unity, remember that that is forged imperfectly. People in my church say something to me, and I think at times, I think, do you have any idea what you just said to me, what it impacts me? Now, at that point, I can raise a ruckus, I could be tempted to punch this brother out. Or I can say, you know, there's a point of ignorance here. There is an insensitivity. I need to stay with this person. They need to stay with me so that we have a chance to forge community. Do I give up my right to not be offended, etc.? So the pursuit, we should take specific steps as best as we're able to identify them, but they will always be forged imperfectly.
Okay. Hannah.
My name is Hannah Andre. I'm teaching church history here at North Park. And this is going back a bit in the conversation, but I wonder whether you would say that we can apply the same invitation and interrogation, right, that you're suggesting to the canon itself, right? If we're trying to, you know, ask what's missing in our hermeneutic, right, does it kind of, in the end, kind of collapse the notion of scripture in the sense that why not look, you know, at the Gospel of Thomas or, you know, any non-canonical texts?
Fascinating implication. Thank you. I want to make a distinction between the canon and the scripture, because I'm a believer that the Bible is recognized as a scripture by the community, whereas the canon is a specific set of books that we're pointing to, and that even the question of the set of books, we have to ask, I suspect that you mean the Protestant canon, not the Catholic canon, right?
I'm thinking earlier. I'm thinking kind of fourth century, like you said.
Okay.
So whether it's Protestant or Catholic, notion of canon.
Right, but for me, at least, it has implications because the canon changed after the Reformation. So in some way, right, in terms of what books are included and what books are not included, in terms of Luther's own opinion about specific books and so on and so forth. So not to circumvent your question. And so I'm saying what's missing, not in terms of what should be added, but I'm saying what is missing in terms of what is there that we haven't paid attention to. And it's a different emphasis that I'm making. Not so much as to what is missing that has already been dealt with by another book. I am dealing with the text as I have it. And so, yes. So thank you for calling me on this. I am assuming the canon as it is. And I'm not assuming that there are other books or that we could add that and complement to it. That's not where I'm going. I am more going in the other direction, as I said, to just ask the text, what's in there? And so why haven't we dealt with it? And what were the circumstances that have contributed to this text to look this way? And what were the circumstances that contributed to the fact that for sometimes centuries, those issues haven't been raised, although they are there. That's where I'm headed. So thank you for bringing that.
Yeah, this will need to be our final question.
Fantastic, since I'm the last presenter, it seems to be the order of the day. To follow up with her question, one of the really interesting insights from African-American hermeneutics, and hermeneutics in general, is the idea of a text within a text. So most Protestants I know, they're going to argue about 66 books in the Bible and read probably 12 of them.
That's right.
So I know you're not trying to get into issues of method,
yeah.
But maybe with this sort of idea of a hermeneutics of what is missing or absent, the part of that might be the text that people in churches do not read, mm-hmm. or text because maybe they're linked to a history of oppression and marginalization. They've turned from those texts. Okay. So that's part of some of what I try to do in reclaiming the need to read a text like Philemon that's linked to slavery. So it's just something you might want to consider. I don't have a question with that, but just wanted to follow up with that.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much. Yes, absolutely. Oh my goodness! I remember a time when I was, my first master's was in theological studies, and I was teaching a course on the Pentateuch, and one of my students took the whole incident in Judges, where this woman is cut to 12 pieces, and as I remember, and I still feel the pain. Of one of my students say, but how can God justify this? How can God order this? And I have to confess, I, in my human limited sense, I had to say, I don't think God did. Because I just cannot imagine a God like that. I just can't. So there is a sense in which those honest questions like this student of mine asked, haven't been asked, and oftentimes because they are told, you shouldn't be asking those kinds of questions. Those are not things that you should be concerned about. And I am kind of just opening the lid a little bit and saying, yes, you should, because it's part of our tradition. And we should celebrate that too, as much as painful as it can be. So.
Okay. Well, please join me in expressing appreciation for us. Okay. So now we have a coffee break. And remember that because of the revision in the schedule, we start again at 11:20. So there's coffee available in Olson Lounge downstairs.